All right. We gave an overview of AJAX last time, and we talked about what it brings to the table, what it provides. And we reviewed that AJAX is not a special programming language or anything, that AJAX is simply a way of using the client and the server side scripting in a different way. Using it to modify an existing web page without having to refresh the whole page. In traditional web programming, when you make a request, you get an entire web page back. Now, that request in that instance is an HTTP request. The difference is that with AJAX, you can use an XML HTTP request to make a request to the server and get back some data. And that data can be used to refresh a page without having to redraw the entire page. The implication of that is you can make web pages act more like desktop applications. All right. The interaction in a traditional web application of making a request, getting back a whole page, requesting another page, getting a whole page is very clunky. All right. Whereas AJAX requests are much more smooth, much more like a regular application. If any of you use Google Docs at all for anything, Google Docs is Google's sort of word processing, presentation tool, spreadsheet application. And it's really nice because you can do a lot of the things that you can do in Word in it. And it has the easy sharing of documents between people and so on. Now, the thing with that, though, is it does a few things for you. It does auto-save, much like Word does. Well, where is it saving it? It's saving it on the server. How can it save it without you clicking a button and it refreshing the whole page? Well, it makes an AJAX request at every certain period of time. It can take the document that you've entered in and save it. So, really, by doing this, you can make a web page be a lot more quickly interactive and a lot more smoothly interactive, as opposed to the sort of clunky interaction of traditional web pages. Now, we looked at the code. We looked at an example, and we looked at the code for a quiz last time and grading a quiz. And we'll review that again more today. But I do want to hit the highlights of the four main parts of an AJAX page. And then we'll go and we'll identify these parts. In the tradition of computer science, I'm going to start numbering with zero. All right? And I'm not just doing that just to be silly. I'm doing that because step zero is sort of a preparation. And that is to create the AJAX object. And AJAX object is probably not the right name for it. Strictly speaking, it is the XML HTTP object. But it's the object that allows us to do AJAX things. So the first step in the process is to create that object. Think of this object as being the pipeline between the client and the server. All right? This is the means by which the client and the server communicate. So we do that right off the bat, so it's ready if we do need to make an AJAX interaction. All right? So we do that right off the bat. So that's a step, but it's sort of a step that happens in preparation for doing an AJAX request. The next three steps are the steps that constitute an XML HTTP request or an AJAX request. And number one is make the request. And usually that involves three things. That involves a URL. In other words, just like in traditional web development where we have a form that submits to a page, we have to submit our request to something. And that something is going to be a server-side script. So we need the URL of that server-side script. Plain and simple. Number two, we need to pass the form data. Well, typically, most of the time, we need to do this anyhow. There could be examples of AJAX requests, like the auto-save in Word or a Google Docs that doesn't require passing really any data. Although, on second thought, I guess that does involve passing data. That involves your document that you're passing that you want to save. But at any rate, we need to pass the data, and typically it's going to be the form data from the client to the server, because we usually want to do something with that data. And the third thing that we pass is what's called a callback function. These two should be fairly straightforward. The callback function is a function that's going to handle the output from the server. So we're going to make that request, and we're going to say, server, when you're done, when the request is done, this is a function on the client side that's going to go and do its thing and sort of complete the request. Now, in this example, we're going to be passing the data on the form on the query string. So it's going to be similar to the way we've made requests before. Then we have a callback function. That's a function that's going to handle the output from the server. Alright? Now, how do we do that? We do it through this. We're going to be using the XML HTTP object that we created in step 0. Step 2 is the simplest step of the processing. That's where the server processes the request. This is a client-side thing. This is a client-side thing. This is a server-side thing. Server processes request. So whatever it needs to do, it might need to look in a database, it might need to do some calculation, it might do a combination of things. But the bottom line is the server responds to the client. In our examples, we'll be using PHP. And all the client side, of course, is going to be handled via JavaScript, because that is the language of client side scripting. Now the difference here is the server is not going to be outputting HTML. The server is going to be outputting just raw data. And what do I mean by raw data? I mean unformatted. And what do I mean by unformatted? No HTML. Just the data. Now that data can be passed back in a number of ways. It can be passed back as what's called a simple sequential file. The data can be delimited, which means that we use a comma or a tab to separate the pieces of the data. The data can be a format called JSON, or the data can be XML. Regardless of that, the best way to do this is to simply send back data. And only data. No formatting. No HTML. Why do I say that? Why do I say no formatting? No HTML? Why do you think I say that? Why is it better just to send back the data and not to send the XML? Any guesses? It probably would be slightly quicker to not send all that stuff back. You'll be sending less data back, so less data means quicker. So that's a possibility. The other possibility is it's more flexible. You know, it is up to the client to decide how it wants to format the data. Which means that I could use the same server-side script to provide data for two different AJAX pages, possibly. Alright? If I had a search, if I had a search by author name, let's say, on a site that dealt with books. That search could be on a couple different pages. And maybe the output gets formatted differently on those two pages. Alright? Well, if the server is simply giving the data, then the client-side script can format it different ways. It's almost like the separation between HTML and CSS. If the HTML is just the data, the content, then CSS can format it different ways. Almost the same idea. If the server simply responds back with data, like a list of books by the author that you searched for, then page A could make a dropdown from that data. Page B could make a table from that data. Page C could do something else with that data. So if we're returning back just data, then there's a clean separation. The server's giving the data, the client side formats it. And remember, it is the client's responsibility to update the page that's being viewed. All right? That's what JavaScript does, is it can go and it can take and it can update the page. Just like we saw a mouse over effect where it can update the page to make a menu appear or disappear. Here it's going to take the data from the server and update the page to include that data. All right, so the server's job is real easy in this scenario. It's responding to requests just like it always has, but it's actually responding in a simpler way. It's just sending data. Now, how does that data get back to the client? It gets back to the client via that XML HTTP object. Every time we do a print, for example, within our PHP code, that says, add that data to the data that is going back through the pipeline. Now, what was I going to say? I just totally lost my train of thought. Depending on the kind of data that is being sent back, it will come back in different places in the XML HTTP object. All right, so as we go over a couple different examples of this, we'll see in one case it comes back in one place, in another case it comes back in another place. Oh, I know what I was going to say. We're using PHP. Ajax does not necessarily have to use PHP. Any server-side scripting that you're using, you could be using Ajax for. Also, there's things built in jQuery that make Ajax life go easier. But again, as is often the case, I think it's important to see the JavaScript is at the root of it before you try to use a tool to do it. It's important to understand how the process works exactly. The last piece is also done on the client side. The client takes the data from the XML HTTP object and that data is used to update the page. All right. So this is the end result. So we're going to view the example that we looked at last time where we graded a quiz, and we're going to analyze each step of this. And we're going to look at it and say, this is step 0, this is step 1, this is step 2, this is step 3. Okay. But all Ajax goes through these steps. This is what makes it an Ajax request. It's the interaction between the client and the server. The client has this role. The client's role is bigger than the server role because the client has to do all this stuff. Server simply just has to give data. Now, there's a lot of work involved in providing that data because that could involve database interaction and so on and so forth. So I don't want to make it sound like the server side gets off too easy, all right? But in terms of steps of the process, it really only does one step while the client does all the steps sort of around it. All right, let's look at the example. And the example we looked at last time was a quiz example, where I dynamically created a quiz and I had server side grade it using Ajax. here is our code. And I'll go and I'm going to go copy this to the server. Now, as we do this again, we still have all the things that we did in regular PHP and JavaScript available to us. So, for example, I use PHP to create the quiz as well as PHP to grade the quiz. All right, let me go here and type in localhost. And we have our two questions. If I get them right, and notice it does this without refreshing the page. You don't notice anything on the page like flicker like you would if it was actually submitting it to the server. This also makes simplifies a lot like what we did last time with the post back, right? Because the code, if we look at our code for our form, the code for our form is going to be real simple because we're not re-requesting it, so we're not re-displaying the form. We just click grade and there is the answers, whether it's correct or incorrect. So let's look at this and let's make sure that we understand how it works, and then we could talk about maybe enhancing it a little bit. All right. So here's our index, and first of all, I want to make sure that we understand how this page is created, because this page has an include file, which is the questions. And the questions are simply in the form of the two numbers that we're going to add together. We have two arrays. We have the first number that we're going to add together, and then we have the second number that we're going to add together. So all the first numbers are in the first array. All the second numbers are in the second array. We don't need an answer array, right? Why not? Because we can calculate that, right? If we know that we're always adding these numbers together, then, well, the program can verify that. Would it be wrong to have an answer array here? I wouldn't say wrong, but I would avoid doing that because that would be an extra thing that you would have to update. Let's say I were to add a question and it was going to be 99 plus 8. Well, I would have to add the answer to the answer array, and I'm liable to get that wrong. So I'm liable to get it inconsistent. All right. And then if I wanted to update this quiz, there were two things I'd have to update, where here there's only one thing I have to update. Or maybe better, there would be two things I have to update instead of three things. So I'd have to update array 1, array 2, and the answer array. Whereas if I'm doing a calculation, I only have to update answer 1 and answer 2. So when this page loads initially, this is before any of the AJAX stuff happens. I call this displayForm function, and the displayForm function creates a global array. What does a global array mean? It means it can be, this array is defined outside of this function. It's declared not part of any function. In other words, the include file, I have add n1 and add n2. That would be inserted simply at this point of the code. So it's not inside of any function. If I say global add n1, add n2, and error message, that means that this function is going to use those variables that were declared outside of the function. I create my form with the method of get. That really doesn't matter because we're not going to submit this form anyhow. We're going to do it AJAX-wise. We loop through for as many questions as there are, how many elements are in that array. We output the first thing plus the second thing, so we output the question, and we create a text box for it. The text box has a name of answer plus $i. So in other words, the first question is going to be, the text box for it is going to be answer 0. And the ID is also going to be answer 0. The next question is going to be answer one, answer two, answer three. Then finally, we have an answer error area so that we can, this is where we put whether they got it right or wrong. So we use that to create, we loop through that to create our questions. All right. Again, what is the reason for this? The reason for this is to make it easy to update. That's our goal in so many things in programming. We put that in an array, and we loop through that array so that if we want to add a question to the quiz, we don't have to go and edit the form at all. We simply add the two values to the arrays, and then boom, all of a sudden we have another question. All right? Does everyone understand that? Any questions with that? So we've created the web page, and in fact, let's look at the HTML that gets generated when we request it. It's always valuable with server-side scripting to look at the HTML that got generated. And in this case, you see, we have the first question, the answer for it is a box called answer 0. And there is a span where we're going to put the results, whether they got it right or wrong. We then have a second question whose name is answer 1. It has an ID of answer 1. And then we have a place to put the error for that as well. Then we have a button, which is not a submit button, right? We're not sending this to the server using an HTTP request. If it was a submit button, the submit buttons make HTTP requests. This makes an XML HTTP request, and those are made via JavaScript. Those are AJAX requests that are made via JavaScript. So on click, we call the grade quiz method. Finally, we have a no script tag, which simply says if you do not have JavaScript enabled. That will tell the person, hey, this isn't going to work because you don't have JavaScript enabled. All right, now into the AJAX stuff. This stuff here is step 0. Remember step 0, what did I say, is preparation? We're creating the AJAX object. We're creating the XML HTTP object. That's what this line of code does. It creates it, and it saves a variable name as HTTP. It does it by calling this function createRequestObject. And this function, you don't even really need to understand it. There's a couple, people have slightly different variations for it, but it generally works the same way. And what it does is it creates the HTTP object, and it returns it. So this is a request object, is created by these statements, and it gets returned. The only difference is the manner in which it creates it. If you are using browser equals Microsoft Internet Explorer, this corresponds to certain versions of Internet Explorer, certain older versions of Internet Explorer. If this condition is true, then the request object is created that way. That's the correct syntax to create the request object for older versions of Internet Explorer. This is the correct syntax to create the request object for everyone else. So as you notice, two possibilities. Either we create it this way or we create it that way. Either way, when we're done, we have a request object that's going to work. It's going to do its thing. Now, this code is going to be identical in all our AJAX applications, right? Because all of them need to do that preparation. All of them need the pipeline between the client and the server to send the data and to get the results. So this creates an object on the browser that is going to communicate with the server. That'll be verbatim, every page. That's preparation. Notice that this instruction doesn't wait until you click a button or anything. It creates that object, so that object is there. It's there ready when you need it. So now we have a variable called HTTP that is going to be our request object. It's going to handle communication with the server and to pass the request to it and to get the results. Now notice, on click we call grade quiz. Grade quiz, in this example, is step one. This is making the request. And what does making the request consist of? Making the request consists of two things, or what do we say, three things. It consists of the URL, passing the form data, and then setting the callback function. Well, here's our URL. This is the name of the PHP script that we're going to call. grade.php question mark. And the question mark indicates that we're going to be passing the data on the query string. This code is going to pass the data on the query string. So this is preparing all the form data. This line of code says this is a callback function. This is the name of the function on this page, client-side JavaScript function, that's going to get called when the request is finished by the server. So sure enough, we look, there it is, handle response. Handle response. So when this script on the server gets finished, handle response is going to get notified that, hey, the request is finished, time to do your thing. All right, time to do your thing. Actually, I misspoke just a teeny bit. I said that this function gets notified when the server is done. That's true, but it actually gets notified at several steps through the process. We're really mainly just interested in when it's done. All right? So it gets notified to say that the server has gotten the request, that the server is working on the request, that the server is almost done with the request, and finally, yep, the server is done with the request. This happens automatically. All right? So we don't have to write any code on the server to do those notifications. Those notifications happen automatically. So this gets notified, again, when the status of the request changes, when the state or status of the request changes. And so it actually gets notified several times. Again, we're only interested in the last update that says, hey, we're finished. All right? So we create the URL. We say who gets notified, then we make the request. Let's look at more detail of making the URL. We start out with the URL being grade.php equals, or question mark. What we want to do is we want to add to the URL answer, the number, followed by the value. So let me go in to Word and show what we want the URL to be. So if we answered if we answered 10 and 20, for example, yes, grade.php question mark answer 0 equals 10 ampersand answer 1 equals 20. So that's what we want the URL to look like. All right? It's always going to be grade PHP. It's always going to be answer 0 equals. It's always going to be answer ampersand answer 1 equals. What's going to get plugged in are these two values, the values from the form. And again, if we have more values, if we had an answer 3, if we had a third question, there'd be an answer 2. All right? And then we'd want ampersand answer 2 equals, ampersand answer 3 equals, and so on, for as many answers as there were. All right, so let's see how we create that. Remember, this part is always going to be there. So, if we look at that, we start out with a URL of grade equals PHP, question mark. We then loop through for I less than, for I equals 0, I less than the number of questions, I plus plus. And what do? We say the URL equals the URL, what it was before, so first time through, it's grade PHP, plus answer plus I. So the first time through the loop, I is going to be 0, so we're going to say answer 0 equals. And then we're going to add on to that the value from the form. So each time through the loop, we're adding answer, whatever the value of the number is, equals whatever the value of the corresponding text box is for that answer. If we're not at the very last question, we're going to add an ampersand because we want an ampersand between all the questions. But we don't want an ampersand after the last question. We don't want that because that makes the browser or that makes the server think that there's more data when there isn't. So we're dynamically creating this URL to look exactly the way we want to be. So it's going to look like this, or whatever the two numbers I put in here. And this is important to remember because the server has to know how we're sending the data over, so the server knows what names to use to pull it off. So when we are done with this, then we go and we set the URL, set the onStatusChange variable, which is the name of the function. Then finally, we say, all right, go ahead and make that request. The request isn't actually made until you execute this. All right, so that goes and it makes the request. So now that server-side script gets called, and it passes those values to it. So the server-side script now does its thing. Now, one thing I would suggest in debugging this is debug it a piece at a time. There's a great... Ajax provides a lot of flexibility, but the one thing that is more difficult with Ajax is debugging it, because there's actually two pieces in Ajax. There's a client side and a server side, and even the client side, there's two pieces of that, right? So what could be going wrong? The first part of the client side, the second part of the client side, or the server side? You don't know. And therefore, you want to take a systematic approach to debugging it. The first thing I would do if my Ajax code was not working is I would see the value of the URL that's getting called. So I would put just an alert here that displayed on the screen the URL. Popped up in a window the URL. So I'm going to save that and I'm going to copy that over. So, when I run this now, when I make the request, excuse me, when I make the request, it shows the URL being made. So I could see the URL being made, and I can see, is that what I'm expecting to send over? You should know what the server-side script is expecting, right? And your client-side's job is to format the request properly to send over what the server-side is expecting. So the server-side's expecting grade.php, and it's expecting answer 0 and answer 1 on the query string. And it's expecting the query string to have the values that are entered in on the form. So if you don't get that, then you know that the rest of it can't work. If you're not making the request the right way, you're not going to get the right response. So nothing else is going to work after this if this isn't done right. All right? So I make sure that that matches what I expect it does. When I do, when I have found that out, then I can go on to debugging the next step if there's still a problem. So the next thing we're going to look at is the server-side code. Now remember, the server-side code is very simple, because all the server-side code does is process the data and return it back. So let's look at the grade PHP. I've included the question, include file. I have for I equals 0, I less than count of add n, I plus plus. I'm grabbing the answer from the query string, right? Where is the answer in the query string? Well, for the first answer, it's answer 0. Second answer is answer 1. This will loop through. Each time through the loop, I is going to have the value of the question that I'm grading. I calculate the correct answer by adding up the values in the two arrays. Then I see if the answer that the user entered in, that is the answer from the query string, matches the answer that I just calculated. If it does, we have a winner, and we print out a Y. If it doesn't, we have a failure, and I print out an N. Finally, I look to see if this is the last time through, because if it's not the last time through, I want a comma between it. So, in other words, if they got both the questions right, I would want to return back Y, comma, N. If they got them, Y, comma, Y. They got the first one right and the second one wrong, Y, comma, N. Both of them wrong, N, comma, N. The first one wrong and the second one right, N, comma, Y. So that's what I want to return. I want to return simply a Y or an N, all right, for each of the two questions, and then I want a comma between those. And that's what I think this code does. All right, it loops through, it grabs the answer, it compares it, it outputs either a Y or an N, and then, unless it's the last question, it outputs a comma. How can I test this? Well, I can test this by simply looking at and running the server-side code without running the AJAX front end. In other words, this is still a server-side script. I can still request it through the browser window. So I could go in and say grade.php ?answer0 equals 10 ampersand answer1 equals 20, and I can run it, and it returns back N and N, which is exactly what we'd want it to return. Now, why does this return it N and N instead of returning and displaying on the page? Well, because I typed in the address physically in the request bar, so I'm making an HTTP request. So it's returning back the whole page. All right. So I can do this to make sure I get the right answers that I'm expecting. If I got them both right, that should be 6 and 12, then it should return Y and Y. And it does. So I can make sure that the server is returning what I expect it to. Remember, when you have components that work together to do a job, there's all sorts of benefits for doing it that way, by building separate components that do things. But the one thing that does get more complicated is the testing of it. Because if it's not working, there could be a problem with component one. There could be a problem with component 2, or there could be a problem in which the component 1 talks to component 2. So you never know where the problem is, you know. There's actually more than two things that could go wrong if you have two components. There's three things that could go wrong, at least. The first component, the second component, or the way that they're communicating. So, I've made sure I'm creating the right URL. I made sure the server is doing its job. Now I'm going to want to go and see how the client processes the data once the request is done. So I now see that the server returns a Y or an N, a comma, and then a Y or an N. So let me look at the code here. Handle response. That's the function that handles a response. That's the function that gets called when it's done. How is it that this function gets called when it's done? Because I told the browser that when the server says that it's all done, call this function on the client side. And again, as I mentioned before, it doesn't just get called when the server's done. It gets called at different steps through the process. And that's exactly what we're checking for here. We are interested in when the ready state equals 4. The ready state equals 4 simply means that the server is done. Let's Google what the other values are. A status of 0 indicates that the request hasn't been sent yet. So if I check the ready state before I sent the request, it would tell me that that is 0. 1 means that the server has gotten the request and has opened it. No. 1 means that it's been opened on the client side. 2 means is that it's been sent to the server. 3 means that it's starting to, the server's starting to send back data. 4 means that it's done. Okay? So, we're interested in the value of 4. When that value is 4, then we know it's done. If we were to look at when the answer is 3, well, we haven't gotten all the data back yet. Now, again, our example is really simple, so it would be hard for us to see those different statuses. They would go by so quick. But in a longer, more extensive request, we're only interested when it's all done. So, what do we do when it's all done? Well, we're getting back what? We're getting back something that looks like this. What we're going to do is we're going to make an array out of this one string. This is one string that gets sent back. And the string that it gets sent back on is the HTTP response text. The response text is where the server places the response when it does a print on the server side. So remember, a print on the server side in a traditional application is what's eventually going to get put on the screen of the user. But when I'm doing an XML HTTP request, the print says put it as part of the response text. So I'm going to go and take the response text, and I'm going to split it into an array using the comma. What does the split do? Well, it's used with delimited data, right? Delimited data is what? Where we have pieces of data that are separated by something. In other words, this piece of data is separated by this piece of data by the comma. The comma isn't part of the data. The comma simply separates the data into fields. So I'm now going to have an array that's going to have array element sub 0 and array element sub 1. So notice how everything is even the whole time, right? Our questions are, you know, our add n1 and add n2 have our arrays that have 2 elements in it. And the response that we get back is an array that has 2 elements in it. What we do then is we loop through those. If they got it correct, then I go and I write the word correct in the inner HTML that corresponds to answer error 1. So remember, we created that when we created the form, a place to put whether they got it right or wrong. And we set the style of that to correct or write. If, however, they got it wrong, we set the style to wrong, and we set the inner HTML to incorrect. So we came full circle, all right? We're now getting the response back from the server, and we're taking that response. The response is every individual question, whether they got it right or wrong. We split that into an array. We loop through for every question. We set the little text area, little text box, or a little span that has text in it that says whether they got it right or wrong. And then we set the class to that, simply to make it stand out. So if they got it right, they see one thing. If they got it wrong, they see something else. Is it better to send back? Now, we could have sent back, instead of sending back whether they got each question right or wrong, we could have sent back simply the number of questions they got right. And we could say, hey, you got two right, or you got one right, or you got zero right. Which is a better way to do it? To send back whether they got each individual question right, or to send back that they got two right, one right, zero right? I'll give you a hint. Which way did I do it? Send back every individual question. Why do you think I did that?
So you can tell them which one they got wrong.
So I could tell which one they got wrong. What if I wanted to change it to only show them how many questions they got right? Could I do that?
Yeah.
I could, right? So in other words, if you think about it, when you're sending data, if you send the detail, you can always summarize it. So if I send each question, whether they got it right or wrong, if I prefer to, I could display, instead of question right, they got question one, they got right. Question two, they got wrong. I could instead display you got one right and not tell them which one they got right or wrong. So I have more flexibility if I send them more detail, because you can always take detailed information and summarize it. If, however, I simply said that you got one wrong, all right, I wouldn't be able to take that data and tell them which one they got right or wrong without changing the program, all right? Again, the idea is the server sends back the raw data. Server doesn't summarize it. The server doesn't format it. The server simply sends back the data to the client. And the client decides how it wants to format it. So the client could, if it wanted to, summarize it. The client could, if it wanted to, format it any way that it wants to. All right, I would suggest between now and Wednesday, studying this, make sure that you understand the basics of AJAX. Because what we're going to do next time is to play around with this a bit and format the output differently, or we might make some errors and intentionally troubleshoot it, or whatever. We might make a couple of little enhancements to this code. But for us to be able to do that, we have to understand the basics first before we can do that. So take a look at this between now and Wednesday, and we'll pick up on this in next lecture. All right. See you in lab.